My name is Bob Dunn. I'm the general manager of Pageant Media's New York office, which owns Portfolio Management Research, PMR, that includes our flagship journal, the Journal of Portfolio Management. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the 20th anniversary celebration of the Bernstein Fabozzi Jacobs Levy Awards. My main duty this evening is to introduce Frank Fabozzi, who has headed the Journal of Portfolio Management for the past 35 years. Since these awards were created as a tribute to Frank and to Peter Bernstein, this is a wonderful opportunity to remind everyone of Frank's impressive credentials. In addition to his responsibility as editor of JPM, Frank is co-editor of the Journal of Financial Data Science and serves as associate editor or advisory board member for the Journal of Fixed Income, the Journal of Structured Finance, Quantitative Methods, Journal of Asset Management, Review of Futures Markets, and the Journal of Derivatives. It's a mouthful. Frank is also professor of finance at EDIC Business School and a member of the EDIC Risk Institute. He also has held faculty positions at Yale School of Management, MIT's Sloan School of Management, Princeton's Department of Operations Research and Financial Engineering, and the University of Karlsruhe Institute of Statistics, Econometrics, and Mathematical Finance. He also serves on the board of directors of BlackRock's Fixed Income Funds Complex, where he chairs the Performance Committee and serves on the Audit Committee. Please give a warm welcome to Frank.
I want to begin by paying tribute to Peter Bernstein. I mean, I inherited a journal that he, was there an applause there? Go ahead. Actually, it's Peter Bernstein and his wife, Barbara, who are the people who, you know, had the idea, sold it to Institutional Investor, and actually developed the journal. So I'm just an add-on in this process. I came on board 12 years later, and working with Peter was terrific. I learned a great deal. I learned a great deal about finance history from him. So when Bruce Jacobs and Ken Levy came and approached us about starting an award dedicated to the 25 years of our contribution, which basically was Peter's contribution to the journal, we were on it. In fact, Peter wrote to me. I think this was a time we didn't communicate that much by email, so I pulled out of my notes. It says, he expressed his interest in what they were doing. He says, Bruce and Ken have themselves been consistently innovative and thoughtful contributors to the journal over the years. And actually, that understates what they had actually done over the years to help develop the journal. So the award that we're here to honor those, honor the recipients, the award had a higher a purpose, which was to promote research excellence in the theory and practice of portfolio management. And we believe this carried out. We're also, later on when I talk a little more about Ken and Bruce, you're gonna find that, you know, JPM is not the only place they help develop awards and achievements for. They are sort of the made cheese of the financial community. They've contributed, we'll talk about what they've done at Wharton to continue to help develop the field. So now I'd like to introduce Bruce and Ken. You know, they've given generously to the journal both their time, okay, and guidance, okay? Both, they're the founders of, the principals and co-founders of Jacob Levy Equity Management. And the firm is widely recognized for its academic research. In fact, we were discussing before that, you know, good number of the contributors here. Basically, if we rated them as academic universities, they probably, in terms of their research performance, would probably be rated one of the top academic institutions. And obviously, they have a very select and prestigious group of roster of institutional clients. Bruce is on JPM's editorial advisory board, and we rely on him a great deal, not only for papers to review, but we also rely on him for providing us suggestions for possible special issues. Okay, and he also serves on the, he's also the chair of the advisory board of the Jacobs Levy Equity Management Center for Quantitative Financial Research at the Wharton School. I mean, they are very generous. Wharton is very fortunate to have both Bruce and Ken as benefactors. Bruce's book, which just came out, is called Too Smart for Our Own Good, Ingenious Investment Strategies, Illusions of Safety, and Market Crashes, where he identifies the common causes of market crashes. And Ken serves on the advisory board also of the Jacobs Levy Equity Management Center for Quantitative Financial Research at Wharton. And he does more than that for the journal. He assists us in many ways. If I need help, both Bruce and Ken will assist me, and they give generously of their time. Both Bruce and Ken are co-authors of Equity Management, The Art and Science of Modern Quantitative Investing. This is a collection of their groundbreaking research that they've done over the last 30 years. And in addition to that, they've also were kind enough to contribute to books that I did on various aspects of equity portfolio management. They're also featured contributors to How I Became a Quant, Insights from 25 of Wall Street's Elite, okay? And with that, let me introduce Bruce and Ken.
Welcome to the 20th anniversary celebration of the Bernstein Fribozzi Jacobs Levy Awards. I'll review some of the history that Frank had touched upon. Peter Bernstein founded the journal Portfolio Management in 1972 and served as editor for its first 14 years. Frank Fribozzi joined the journal as managing editor in 1984 and became editor 2 years later. To celebrate the journal's 25th anniversary and to honor Peter and Frank for their extraordinary contributions to the investment community, we approached them in May 1998 with the idea of creating an award for outstanding papers. As you can see, a copy of the original letter is up on the screen. It was our hope that the Bernstein Fribozzi Jacobs Levy Awards would foster and promote research excellence in the theory and practice of portfolio management. I vividly recall my conversation with Peter after he received our letter. He thought it was a marvelous idea, and he wanted to get it underway right away. Peter announced the Bernstein Fribozzi Jacobs Levy Awards in the summer 1998 issue. Subscribers to the journal cast their first votes for best and outstanding articles in the fall of 1999. And the first awards were announced in the winter 2000 issue.
We wanted to make the selection process for the awards truly democratic. JPM subscribers are invited to select up to 4 articles, designating each as best, second, third, or fourth. Votes are submitted electronically, and the journal staff tabulates the results. We put in place conflict of interest standards. Authors may not vote for their own articles, and articles authored or co-authored by Frank, are not eligible for an award. The roster of winners is truly impressive. Literally a who's who of the leading minds in portfolio management from both the academic and practitioner communities. We're delighted that so many winners are here with us tonight. The breadth of scholarship represented by the award winners is remarkable. The authors have tackled many of the most compelling issues facing investors and portfolio managers over the last 2 decades. To name just a few, the active-passive debate, behavioral investing, factors, market crises, risk management, and valuation.
Every 5 years, as you all know, we reach out to the award-winning authors for commentaries and collect them, along with the original articles, into an anthology. The commentaries discuss the motivation behind the articles and their ongoing research. The volumes also feature an introduction by Frank myself, and Ken that provides perspectives on the research topics covered, the historical setting, and the impactful contribution of each author. Jacobs Levy is pleased to offer complimentary copies of volumes 1 through 4, representing all 20 years of the awards, to everyone here tonight. You are the first to receive the newly published volume 4. Some of our Bernstein Fabozzi Jacobs Levy award-winning authors will share their thoughts with us this evening. Frank will introduce our first speaker.
Okay, our first speaker is Mayor Statman, and for many years he's been a leading researcher and has taught us a lot about behavioral finance. And basically, he's taught us that every investment model should consider the heuristics and cognitive biases that affect our actions. In fact, in his first time, this is not his first award, he wrote a paper that received the Outstanding Article Award in 2000 with the appropriate title, Cognitive Biases in Market Forecasts. We traced how biases can give rise to the false notion that PE ratios and dividend yields will provide us with reliable forecasts of future stock returns. He's also here to receive the Best Article Award, where he finds that markets are not efficient, but they're really tough to beat. You need exclusive information or narrowly available information. He's a leading researcher in behavioral finance. That's what he received. He's going to receive both awards for the last two awards. And I said last two awards because I expect he's going to receive one in another area, which unfortunately he doesn't boast about his work in the area of ethical investing, okay, which is obviously a hot topic. He has a forthcoming paper, okay. He's the Glenn Klimek Professor of Finance at Santa Clara University. So please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you, Frank, and good evening to all of you. So I will speak briefly about a book that is about to be published that's called Behavioral Finance, The Second Generation, and I will, of course, explain it. So we often hear that behavioral finance is a nice bunch of stories about people who are irrational and so on, but it does not have the rigor, it does not have the heft of standard finance. And to that I say nonsense. The behavioral finance, especially the second generation of behavioral finance, has all the building blocks of standard finance, except that they are better, except that they fit reality better. So in standard finance, people are rational. In the first generation of behavioral finance, we went too far to the other side and we declared them irrational, predictably irrational, a bumbling set of idiots. And I think that it is time to bring it back to the middle, to bring it to people like me and you, normal people. Now, we have behavioral portfolio theory, we have behavioral asset, behavioral life cycle theory, behavioral asset pricing theory, and we have behavioral notions of market efficiency. So let me speak to them very fast. So when we are normal, neither rational nor irrational. Normal people have normal wants. One of the things that is missing in standard finance and the first generation of behavioral finance is that focus on what it is that people want. People obviously want more than wealth. And both standard finance and the first generation of behavioral finance assume that that is what people want first and last. So yes, normal people do commit cognitive and emotional errors, but they commit them on the way to what they want, and that is crucial. So what are some wants of people, and what are the benefits people look for? Think about nurturing our kids. This is common to all. There are utilitarian benefits in a 529 account, for example, for children's education. I will have money to support my kids through their education, but there are also expressive benefits. It says, I am a responsible parent, and there are emotional benefits. I am proud to be able to support my kids. Think about socially responsible investing, ESG as it is called now. One, I'll have high returns, but also I am socially responsible and I have peace of mind because my money and my values are aligned. And we all want high social status, you know. We don't speak about it. We see it in other people and not in ourselves, but we all care about status. And so why, for example, we buy hedge funds? Well, I would say that one reason is that in a social setting, you cannot say, hi, I'm Mayor Stadtman and I'm a rich man, but you can drop a hint that you're into hedge funds and people, in fact, hear the same thing, except that you did not break any social rules. So how do I know that you are normal? Everybody is normal. How do you identify it? Ask yourself, do you have normal wants? And do you commit cognitive and emotional errors sometimes on the way to your wants? I think that the answer is yes to both. And so let me talk about portfolios very quickly. So in standard finance, we have mean variance portfolio theory, where the portfolio is one blob and we have an attitude towards risk. I say we don't have an attitude towards risk. We have wants. On the way to those wants, we take risks. The people who cross the Mediterranean on rickety boats are not people who like risk. They want desperately something better than be in a war-torn country. And of course, it takes a bit of willingness to take risk to do that. And so risk, first of all, portfolios then are the old pyramid of wants. We want to retire, that is at the bottom of the pyramid, but we also want a chance to be rich. And so we don't have one attitude towards risk, we have many, depending on those wants. And risk, I say, is definitely not volatility, but it is the price that we pay for a chance to satisfy our wants. Let me talk about life cycle of saving and spending. Now, young people often have a problem of self-control, so that they find themselves spending too much and they have to exercise self-control to save and accumulate this amount of money. And so we use rules, we use mental account, you know, here's money for saving, here's money for spending. And we have rules that say spend income, but don't dip into capital. Now, the interesting thing is that insufficient self-control is common, but excessive self-control is just as common. And people who are older find that it's really hard. Those who have been conscientious, saved a lot, find it really hard to break this habit of saving and start spending. And you can see reactions to that. You know, that is, if I were at a restaurant paying $300 for something super duper extra deluxe, I will have a feeling that somebody is laughing there in the back at that idiot statman who is paying, you know, for something, you know, that is chopped liver on toast that is called something in French. And then lots of people, you ask them, why don't you spend the money, not just on yourself, but kids, family, community. Some people just like to kind of count it every night to see how rich they really are. Let me talk about asset pricing. We see that a per se dinner, or lunch actually, will cost you $295 to begin with. But McDonald's might have the same nutrition at $5. So we are not shocked to see that there are those disparities in pricing. So obviously, there is something about meals that is beyond the utilitarian benefits of calories and nutrients. There is prestige, there is atmosphere, there is how it looks, how it smells. People are willing to pay for that. Now I say, why do you think that financial assets are different from that? Financial assets are consumer products. People don't just stop and say, whoa, now we have to be rational and just focus on the utilitarian. Think back of socially responsible investing, think about status investing, and so on. And so it is time to kind of get out of this notion of risk factors. These are not risk factors. These are simply factors that account for utilitarian benefits and costs, expressive benefits and costs, and emotional benefits and costs. And so you can see, I mean, I even developed a kind of a toy model that has factors for social responsibility that go into that. And last, let me talk about market efficiency. Now, there are two notions of market efficiency that get confused. One is that price is always equal to value. That really is the important one. And if you look at Farmer's 1965 article, this is how he defines it. But we have experienced kind of a bait and switch where now it is, can you beat the market? Now, if price is always equal to value, you cannot beat the market. But if you cannot beat the market, it does not mean that price is equal to value. And so we have to look at it and ask ourselves, one, what do we know about each of these? Is price equal value? And how hard it is to beat the market? And then why do so many naive amateur investors think that beating the market is easy? Now, markets are hard to beat. There are many of you who are in the business and successful at beating the market. But then it makes the puzzle even greater. Why is it that idiots choose to compete against you? And for that, you have to look further. So first, just to illustrate, bubbles cannot exist in price equal value markets, but they can exist and they can persist in hard to beat markets. So, you know, we know now that there was a bubble in 2007, but are we in a bubble now? At least we know that it's a more difficult question to answer. So the way I say it is, yes, markets are crazy, but this does not make you a psychiatrist. Some people do beat the market, professionals do, people with inside information do, but amateur investors, in fact, get the short end. So why is it that investors do that? Why is it that amateur investors play a game where they are destined to lose? This takes us back to this area of cognitive and emotional, I think, of framing. Amateur investors think of trading as the equivalent of playing tennis against a practice wall, but trading is playing real tennis against an opponent on the other side. And as I like to say, in every trade there is an idiot, and if you don't know who it is, you are in trouble. And so you have a whole range of them, and there are emotions, you know, that is when you ask people, why do you play video games? They say it's fun, but somehow they cannot say that trading is fun. Trading is to make money. But it is not, you know, so come clean and say that you just like those green and red numbers on the screen. And then some of it really has to do with what it is that you want. People trade, people invest because they want riches, they want high social status. There are lots of people who are not going to build the new Amazon or Google. They are closer to retirement, they buy lottery tickets, and they trade or they invest in kind of their own special way. And so again, just to come back, if you ask about what are kind of the central issues of finance, they are about people, being rational or normal, behavioral portfolios, life cycle theory, asset pricing, and market efficiency. Thank you all very much.
It's my pleasure to introduce Andy Lowe, whose thoughtful questioning of our foundational thinking about markets has earned him 3 Bernstein Fabozzi Jacobs Levy Awards, including one for Best Article. Andy's first outstanding article, The Adaptive Markets Hypothesis, which appeared in 2004, found that the EMH and behavioral finance are not irreconcilable. The article posited that investors are largely rational and, though prone to make mistakes, are able to adapt and learn from them. His next outstanding article, 130-30, The New Long Only, in 2008, Andy and co-author Patel took on the task of proposing a benchmark for the then-emerging 130-30 strategy. Their solution was outside the box, a dynamic portfolio that was transparent, investable, and passive. Andy's best article from 2016, What is an Index?, brought some welcome clarity to our thinking about index funds in this age of smart beta products and levered investing. While new indices can offer more sources of diversification and risk sharing and greater flexibility, they can also bring on subtle risks. Andy is the Charles and Susan Harris Professor of Finance at the MIT Sloan School of Management. We are delighted to hear tonight from one of the most forward-thinking minds in investing. Please join me in welcoming Andy.
So I want to thank Ken for that very generous introduction, and for Bruce, Ken, Frank, and all of the folks at Journal Portfolio Management and Jacobs Levy for giving us the occasion to gather together tonight. I have to say that it's an incredible honor for me to be part of this group, because I have learned a tremendous amount from all of the authors of the Journal Portfolio Management, including all of the prize winners that are being honored today. And I want to give you a little bit of perspective on what it means for an academic, because the Journal Portfolio Management is not primarily an academic journal. It was started up by a practitioner, and many of the authors are from practice. And you might think that, as a result, academics wouldn't take it seriously. And actually, that's true for most practitioner journals. But that's not true for the Journal of Portfolio Management. Part of the reason is because of Peter Bernstein and the legacy that he created. And I was very privileged to have interacted with Peter towards the very end of his tenure at the Journal of Portfolio Management. In those days, we didn't have as much email communication as we had now. And Peter never communicated to me by email. He would send me this little 3x5 notes, very neatly typewritten with his signature. And I treasure those. I've kept all of them. But in addition to the franchise that Peter created, Frank took it to another level. And I have to argue that, from my own perspective, Frank really brought the Journal of Portfolio Management into the more modern era of financial research, one that I benefited from personally with the articles that I've written and the research that I've done. Frank and I actually go back quite a ways. I started out as a junior faculty member at the Sloan School after spending 4 years at Wharton. And Frank was there as a visitor, was there for a number of years, and was one of the most popular lecturers. And I still remember him meeting with me on occasion. Many of the senior faculty either didn't have time or I was too scared to talk to them, but Frank talked to me. And I remember at one point he had a master's thesis on his desk. In those days, you had to write a thesis in order to graduate from the Sloan master's program. And it was a master's thesis that Frank co-advised with one of my more theoretically inclined colleagues, Chifu Huang. Some of you may know Chifu, and you know he's very, very theoretical, very, very mathematical. Frank, much more practical. And in fact, when Frank was advising the student, he was very helpful in getting a student a job. And so the student told me about the experience. And then I looked at this thesis on Frank's desk, and I said, oh, you mind if I take a look at it? And Frank said, sure. And in the acknowledgments, the student wrote, I would like to thank my 2 advisors, Chifu Huang and Frank Fabozzi, for advising this master's thesis. I would like to thank Chifu for what he knew, and I'd like to thank Frank for who he knew, because Frank got him a job. And at that point, I realized now the difference between theory and practice. Let me make one more comment about the Journal of Portfolio Management in particular, which is that part of the reason that this journal plays such a special role in academia is because of the people that publish in that journal. And in particular, I want to point to an article that was published in 1974 by an academic, one that is from MIT. A fellow that you might have heard of, his name is Paul Samuelson. And in 1974, he published an article titled Challenge to Judgment, questioning the whole idea of active management and asking whether or not, even though there are talented active managers out there, for the typical investor, it's kind of hard for us to know who that is. And so wouldn't a reasonable alternative be a low or no load fund that would basically put together a broad cross-section of securities in no particular order or ranking, but just simply based upon the fact that they are part of the US equity market? Wouldn't that be an interesting alternative? That was published in the Journal of Portfolio Management. It turns out that that article was read by a young man who was just starting out in his career and thought, gee, you know, this kind of makes sense. And the fact that it's published in a journal, well, it must be right. And so this young man decided to do something about it. His name was Jack Bogle. And he started the Vanguard Fund. He credits that article as actually changing his perspective. And so the combination of Paul Samuelson and Jack Bogle and all of these other luminaries that have been honored by the Jacobs Levy and the Bernstein Fabozzi Award, this is what gives us academics the motivation to continue publishing in this amazing journal and to be part of this rich tradition that Bruce and Ken have started by honoring those. And I'm just so grateful and humbled to be part of the company that's in this room today. The paper that I wrote on 13030, I co-authored it with Pankaj Patel. Pankaj is here today. Pankaj is a practitioner. He and I met just through interactions in our joint our interest in this area. And the fact that it should receive the recognition of the people in this room is just, you know, incredibly flattering and humbling to me. So I want to thank you all for being here and for being part of this incredible business that I'm lucky enough to count myself in. Thank you.
I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, Cliff Asness. You'll find his outstanding research in each of the four volumes. Cliff is a six-time winner, including three Best Article Awards. Cliff earned his first Best Article Award for his 2001 paper, Do Hedge Funds Hedge, co-authored with Crail and Liu. This offered a critical examination of hedge fund performance. He won another Best Article Award for Fight the Fed Model, a skeptical look at this popular yardstick for market valuation. The following year, he took home an Outstanding Article Award for An Alternative Future, Part 2, a prescription for making hedge funds more user-friendly. Cliff's 2013 article, The Devil in HML's Details, earned him and co-author Frazzini Best Article for challenging the Fama French method of measuring the value factor. Two subsequent articles won Outstanding Article Awards in Fact, Fiction, and Value Investing from 2015. Cliff and co-authors Frazzini, Israel, and Moskowitz conducted a wide-ranging examination of value investing. In the 2018 article, Buyback Derangement Syndrome, another of Cliff's understated titles, co-authored with Hazelkorn and Richardson, they challenged myths about stock repurchases. Cliff is a thought leader in the industry and a founder of AQR Capital Management. Please join me in welcoming Cliff.
It's a pleasure to be here with old friends, savage competitors, and the considerable overlap of those two. I will work some of you into my comments. I cannot begin without starting without a Frank Fabozzi story. I got to know Frank sometime probably in the mid to late 1980s. Early on, he asked me to write a paper. I was young and naive enough. Not that this was the point. I knew it was really advertising and getting your name out there. But I was young and naive enough to think you get paid something for getting an article in one of Frank's books. And I remember asking him, so what do you get paid? He goes, you get 25 books. And I'm like, what do you get paid? He goes, you can sell the books. So I still have this image of like putting a table out, like one of those people in New York City with like, and just the other guys selling coloring books, and I got Fabozzi here. Probably the person I know longest in the room is actually the speaker before me, Andy Lowe. He was my professor as an undergraduate. I worked for him, actually, as a kind of coder. And he wrote one of my recommendations to the University of Chicago in 1988. I know a lot of people in this room for a long time, but I think that's the longest one. So in that sense, it's kind of Andy's fault. I have a pretty long history with the Journal of Portfolio Management, even before Ken and Bruce's extremely generous beginning of this award. The first published paper I ever wrote, now Marty, I'm going to work you into this story. Bruce mentioned my titles. A few things. Along with some of the same co-authors, there is a paper entitled, essentially it's Size Matters If You Can Control Your Junk. Everyone in the world thinks I came up with that title because it's a little out there. Professor Toby Moskowitz of Yale University came up with that title. I liked it. Ronan is a co-author. He liked it. We spent the whole time with that title waiting for them to tell us we couldn't use it. You know, you submit the paper, they accept the paper, you're excited, and you keep waiting, and they publish it under that title. So my first paper in the Journal of Portfolio Management, I had not yet learned to come up with good titles. It was called Option Adjusted Spreads and a Steep Yield Curve. It's a TV movie waiting to happen. I had just gotten a new boss at Goldman Sachs. I was taking a year off from the PhD program trying to figure out what I wanted to do. And she had her doubts about me, to be blunt. I think she found me brash and bumptious. I don't know where she would get that impression. But she worshipped Marty Leibowitz, who read my paper in the Journal of Portfolio Management and at a joint meeting was very complimentary to it, and I think it saved my career. I think I got to start the quantitative research group at Goldman Sachs because of the Journal of Portfolio Management. A different paper was read by PIMCO, who was looking to start a quant group. I went to Goldman and I said, I think I'm gonna go do this, guys. I like this. They said, why don't you start the group here? I said, New York City is far more attractive than Newport Beach, California. Though the Journal of Portfolio Management has also gotten me in trouble at times. I think my second paper in there, again, pre-award, I'm sure these all would have won awards. I gave myself the award kind of posthumously. Posthumously is kind of a negative word for that. Was called Why Not 100% Equities? And as a response to a precisely same title paper, Why Not 100% Equities, with Dick Thaler. Pre-Nobel Prize, I wouldn't take on Dick now that he has a Nobel Prize, but pre-Nobel Prize. His paper was essentially saying a long-term investor should be all equities and was stated with a question mark. Mine removed the question mark and underlined not. I think I've gotten to be friends with Dick over 20, 25 years since then, but I started out in a very deep hole because of this paper. So of any one of them, that's the one you probably shouldn't have accepted. The other one that got me in serious trouble was the first one Bruce mentioned, Do Hedge Funds Hedge? We wrote a paper showing that hedge funds have fairly large market betas and considerably larger than people thought. This room would appreciate it. They don't mark everything to market. They're not like private equity not marking to market, but they still have some illiquid securities, and not everything trades all the time. So standard regressions and whatnot will understate their betas. And essentially, we found they had larger betas than prior studies, and that means if the market premium is positive, which it which it certainly was over this period, that their alphas are smaller. All well and good. You don't write this paper and feel and still think you're going to have a pleasant life living in Greenwich, Connecticut. I got about 10 phone calls from famous, we were not known by anybody, from famous people just yelling at me. I'd sit in the diner and I'd get a little point that that's the guy who wrote the paper. So, you know, it's been net a wonderful ride, but the Journal of Portfolio Management has cost me on occasion. I'm not going to surprise anyone in this room by saying, and Andy already talked about it, the journal and the award we're all here to justly praise and honor sits at a rather unique nexus of both academia and practitioner work. There are very few outlets for things like that. I, for one, appreciate its existence. I appreciate this award probably more than almost anything, because it's really chosen by people like this in this room, which makes it very special. And so I'd like to thank the journal, Frank Fabozzi, Peter Bernstein, and Ken and Bruce. It's really been one of the highlights of my career. Thank you.
Now it's time to present the awards. And the first award for outstanding paper, and the three of them, goes to Lauren Martinelli and Vincent Milau for his proverbial baskets or uncorrelated risk factors, a factor-based framework for measuring and managing diversification in multi-asset investment solutions. Okay, that was part of our special series, I believe, on multi-asset strategies. The next award is for Cliff Asness, Todd Hazelcorn, and Scott Richardson for buyback derangement syndrome. The final outstanding award goes to Cam Harvey, Edward Oyle, Russell, Sandy Raytray, Matthew Sargason, and Otto Van Hemmer. And I apologize for abusing names. And for the best article is someone who will be a frequent participant up here, Mayor. Yeah. Congratulations to all the winners.
We thank you all for the past 20 years of outstanding scholarship. We're confident that the next 20 years will certainly meet, if not beat, expectations.
Beginning with the 21st year of the awards, we are increasing the cash prizes to $2,500 for each outstanding article and $5,000 for each best article. Voting for the 21st annual awards opens on December 1st. Thank you for coming and sharing this very special evening with us.
All right, thank you, Bruce and Ken, for your unending generosity and support. Thank you for attending, I appreciate that. And hopefully we'll see you again soon. Thank you, bye now.